Oh, welcome back to another episode of Nutra TV. Today we're here to talk about total coliforms and E-Coli monitoring in drinking water.
So, total coliforms, obviously we're required to monitor them under the current standards that were revised in 2018. They were brought in as a thing then, and under the quality assurance rules that we are proposed by Tomat Arawai, we've got to continue to monitor total coliforms. I suppose the biggest question in a lot of people's minds is, you know, why are we monitoring total coliforms? What's the point, I guess?
Well, and particularly if there's no limit, actually, in our reticulated water, right? I mean, you've got to report them, but what's...
Well, I guess the thing about total coliforms is that they're much more sensitive. You know, they're much more prevalent than E. coli. E. coli is like, I've had fecal contamination of the water. And total coliforms is more like, well, there's biological activity.
So, I mean, that's a clear difference. So if we have E. coli in the drinking water, we know for sure we have a contamination with a very high likelihood of a pathogen issue, yep. Which we have. Total coliforms, in contrast to that, total coliforms are much more present. If I got total coliforms in a source water or something like that, that does not necessarily mean that I have a pathogen in my water.
No, and I think the nice thing about in the source water, I mean, kind of whether we look at source water first or treated water, but let's look at source water first.
Okay. And
in the source water, by monitoring in the source water, you're kind of deciding what's going on in there. It's about knowing your source water. It's about knowing what's going on.
Knowing the baseline.
Yeah, so the trouble with E. coli is the baseline's kind of zero.
Yep.
So it can't go down from zero. So you can't see the water quality getting better. Whereas if you've got a baseline that's not zero, if the water quality gets better, you can see that. But you can also see if it gets worse, right?
So for example, in certain events, in a contamination event or like runoff, you can have that strong weather events, things like that. So we got to say a baseline of 500 CFU of total coliforms, which is something which you quite likely can have in river water, things like that. That might be our general baseline, but we need to understand the dynamics, so to say, of our source water. So we got, say, a strong rain event or anything like that that shoots up to 10,000, 20,000, something like that. So we know if we get peaks like this, they're associated with certain events. So in retrospect, we can also draw conclusions from that. We expect these events. We need to look at these to understand what's going on, have appropriate treatment, well-designed treatment per se.
Yeah, so, I mean, typically when you get a stormwater event, 10,000 would not be unusual coliforms, after runoff, stormwater runoff.
Yeah.
And you need to know whether your treatment process is going to be able to handle that peak.
Yeah.
Right, and that's the key thing. So whilst because you're not going to get a result, if you send your result off to a lab, it's going to come back the next day. So it's kind of too late. It's already happened.
Well,
The next time you get a rainfall event and you get the stormwater runoff, you know that it's going to peak like that.
Well, it's basically a learning.
Yeah.
It's a learning of your source, an understanding of your source, these kind of things. The other thing is obviously we need to probably up our sampling schemes and design them accordingly so we can see on shorter time frames what's happening. I mean, having a response time of 1 to 2 days might not cut it in many cases. It's kind of too late. So there's obviously there's been some other modern technology around of online bacteria monitors which can come into use there as well as part of the toolkit.
So they might speed things up a bit.
Yeah.
But they're not necessarily going to give you that I've got a problem now. It might be a problem in
you need to be prepared for that.
Yeah. So the online monitoring is telling you is that if I get an event, I know where it's going to go. I know what the limit's going to be, so I can deal to it. Mm. And it's about getting so you can preempt what's going to happen either by reducing your intake or increasing your chlorine dose or UV dose
source.
Or whatever you're going to do. It kind of doesn't matter. But doing nothing is, you know, you've just got to be more vigilant at those times. But that goes back to what you're saying about event-based sampling.
Yeah.
So the standards call for us to do, you know, da-da-da-da-da sampling. But what we should be doing is that sampling to get our baseline. But when there's an event, increasing the sampling frequency to maybe doing, instead of doing one test, we do 3 or 4 tests over an 8-hour period or something.
Yeah. I mean, you need to know when you're coming back to your baseline as well. Mm. Otherwise, the other thing is with our regular testing of once a week, once a month, whatever it has been in some places, you miss out a lot. Well, there might be an event you never know of it.
Well, at the moment, under the 2018 revision, you don't have to sample the source water.
Yeah, fantastic.
It's kind of like, So I guess where we're going with source water monitoring is it's really important to understanding what's going on in your source water.
Yeah.
And it's just another tool in the toolbox to understand that. And it goes back, you know, goes back to the six principles, and both change precedes contamination, and you know, protecting your source water is of paramount importance. You know, those are key things we have to do, and this is another tool in the toolbox to enable us to do that.
But I mean, shouldn't we also measure and monitor the source water as well as the treated water? I mean, you've got to see how efficient your treatment process is per se.
Yeah, it's interesting because in the current standards, we have to monitor total coliforms on the outlet of the plant.
Yeah.
I think I read the quality assurance rules a number of times, and I can't find it in there that you have to monitor it after the treatment plant.
Which would, in my
you have to monitor it in the reticulation.
A wise thing to do.
Yeah, you have to monitor it in the reticulation, in the brown reservoirs, bulk points, and wherever else you're going to do it. But you don't have to monitor it at the treatment plant, which kind of I would have hope that people would do that anyway.
You want to see the efficiency of your treatment plant, by the way.
Yeah, I would.
Basically.
So, me personally.
But I mean, if we go further into the process and we monitor in our reticulation, what does that tell us? And I mean, if we're monitoring for total coliforms and there's no limit for that in the reticulation, where's the difference there again?
Well, I think the limit's actually zero, right? They should be zero total coliforms after treatment.
But what's the guideline?
Well, there is no guideline.
Yeah.
But the point I'm making is that everything we do should be getting that total coliforms to that zero number, right? And if it's not zero, we've got a problem.
Yeah.
Not right now, but we might have a problem soon. We have a contamination pathway that's there, and it could recontaminate that water.
So to clarify again, we're talking about total coliforms here, which can indicate that there's an issue, obviously not E. coli. If we got E. coli, it's got to be zero.
That's a whole
what.
E. coli is zero. As soon as you have E. coli, if you get a positive E. coli, borewort notice, and all the measures that need to take place, regional public health, you know, health department, tomato ROI, and that's really, really bad. We do not want that.
But
total coliforms is slightly different.
So that brings to that, if we get a total coliform positive result, whatever it may be, 1,500, whatnot, first of all, why is it there? I thought chlorine kills all coliforms.
Well, it kind of, so there's two ways you could get a positive total coliform and chlorine. Chlorine's very effective at killing total coliforms and killing bacteria in general and viruses.
But we got decent residual chlorine, you can even smell it or something like that. Yeah. Why could you have...
Well,
there's two ways
to get it predominantly. One is that you've got a contamination of the sample, which everybody assumes, which isn't always true.
No. Mm-hmm.
And the other way is that even if your chlorine residuals are high and you've got total coliforms, what that means is you've probably had a massive contamination event or potential contamination event. So if you take, normally you're running at zero total coliforms, you get a contamination event and you start with 10 million total coliforms. If you do a four log reduction of that, you've still got 1,000 left.
That's about what you expect with the chlorination.
Well, it depends
four
on
log
the,
reduction.
It depends on the amount of chlorine and the contact time, CT value. But if you've got a lot of chlorine there, then potentially you've got a high CT anyway, even if the time's relatively short. So you should be killing four log, you know, 99.99% of chlorine. But if you start at 10 million, that's still 1,000 left or more.
Plenty left.
Right. So if you've got one total coliform, you probably started with 10,000, which is a lot.
That's actually quite contaminated.
That's quite contaminated, right? Yeah. So if you have total coliforms and chlorine residual, it means you've got a problem.
Yeah.
And you could be looking at that point at a whole bunch of other data. And if your chlorine residual's just dipped a bit, that's another sign that you might have contamination. So you've got to look at all that data.
There are various things to look at there. There's obviously... Is your chlorination process running right?
Yeah.
So if it dipped, what has happened?
Yeah.
If there are other parameters to look at, do we have water ingress? Do we have any other form? So it's basically like doing a very, very detailed investigation on where that would have come from. I mean, the first thought is like, we got total coliforms present, boy, water notice.
Well,
yes or no?
No, I wouldn't go that far. Because if you have total coliforms, that in itself is not contamination.
Yeah, that's basically what we said in that sense. But still, we don't know in that moment. And there's a risk. But say we can eliminate the risk.
Yep.
we measure for pathogens,
yep.
something like that. We're quick enough. What do we need to do? I mean, well, in that sense, we can't just ignore that and saying, it'll go away, we won't have it again.
Yeah. I think, and there's been a little bit too much of that over the course of the last 20 or 30 years. But I think if you get a positive E. coli, and you've kind of decided that it is, sorry, positive E. coli, I didn't mean that. I meant a positive total coliform.
I think if we get a positive E. coli,
the world stops spinning and everybody flies off, yes. So if you get a positive total coliforms, I think at that point, you've got to start doing an examination of where it came from. And if we think about, go back to that, we must have a high standard of care in our water supplies. And if you look back at the Havelock North, it relates it to aviation or medicine, right?
Yes.
So when they have a near miss, they go back and they look at the all the things that might have caused it, and they try and identify the cause so they can prevent it from happening again. Yeah. If we think of a total coliform positive result as a near miss, then I think... we should treat it in the same way. So it's near miss. Go watch an episode of Air Crash Investigation, and that's the level of investigation we should be doing for total coliforms every time we get one.
Looking at very, very detailed forensics in that case. But
potentially, yeah. I mean, yeah. But, they look at the voice recorder, they look at the flight data recorder. We need to go back and look at our data we have available.
We've got a network and a range of sources we need to look at.
We need to look at potential contamination sites. We need to go and investigate the site.
I think near miss is a key word there. Near misses are used anywhere in work safety, et cetera, and they always should, by proper protocol, prompt A, a report, no question, but B, if you just file that away, how good is that? There's got to be some sort of a plan coming out of that. What if we report a near miss? Normally, you'd look at what's happened. What do we do to prevent that? That's the absolute key.
And
there.
It might be procedural. It might be a work practice. Yeah. It might be infrastructure that we have to change. That's something that should come out of that, yeah.
So two things I see out of here is, A, when we look at our reticulation, A, we need to have a decent monitoring plan in the reticulation so we actually can pick these things up, otherwise we'll miss them like we have. And the other thing is we need to have a proper response plan if we pick something up.
Yes, and certainly a proper investigation plan.
Yeah.
Because the response to... the investigation is different to the response to a total.
Of course.
You've got to investigate it and then decide what to do.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. And I think that's absolutely key in all of this, yeah.
Yeah. So in summary, I think we can say that we measure total coliforms in parallel to E. coli for two very different reasons. E. coli being our clear indicator, yes, we have a very high likelihood of a pathogen contamination in our water. And our total coliforms are the tools in the toolbox to have a continuous monitoring. We have a certain baseline. We know what can be there. And if these dynamics change, we need to start looking on what happened. And we need to have adjusted plans to this, so to say.
Yep, I think that's absolutely right. And as you said earlier, the way we do this, it needs to be planned. You can't just do ad hoc sampling. And I think that's absolutely key to this. There needs to be a plan, and there needs to be a planned response.
Yeah. Yep. Ad hoc or ignore is simply
not an
option.
Acceptable. No, not anymore.
Greatest care of safe drinking water.
I think so. And I think when we look at the six principles of safe drinking water, this does cover feed into a lot of them.
Yep.
So. We talked about protection of the source water, we talked about high standard of care, we talked about change procedures, contamination, you've got multi-barrier approaches, all of that is part of, this is to validate all that system. So,
clearly these tools are part of the barriers.
Yes, absolutely.